Do not look for answers. Practice having already received the answer. This is what we do here. So, this is how we get what we really want, is we practice the feeling like we already got it. This is the entire key to success. Now, once we practice like this, the answers will arise easily. This is what I found. So we're in the shock of having already received the answers that we were looking for. So to get this emphasis, we're in the shock of having already received the answers that we were looking for, the help that we were looking for. We received exactly what we wanted. So how do we feel about that? Isn't that a great shock? Did we expect it? So it's this shock of receiving what it is that we really want. This is what we have to focus on. The answers are already there. The answers are very simple. The answers come like that. Today, the answers came to me. So what am I doing? I'm in the shock of having got those answers and not second guessing it. That is the way to practice. So we have it backwards in the world. So when you go to satsang, you go to prayer, you go to some sort of communion, you go to service, etc. It's you're going there and you're putting yourself in this mode of, I don't have any needs. I don't have any needs at all. I've already received everything that I need. I've already received everything that I need. So this paves the way for clarity to arise. Paves the way. So today, the answers already arose. What do you do then? So practice. What do you do once you get the answers? People ask questions. Can you answer this? Well, what are you going to do once you get the answer? This is the better question. What are you going to do once you get the answer? Practice that. Or how are you going to feel once you get the answer? How are you going to respond? What is going to be your reaction to getting the answer that you've been searching for? Irrespective of what the labels and words are, the fact that it's been resolved, you got what you were looking for. How do you feel about that? Now, it's very cold here today. So it's quite amazing. The weather just suddenly became very odd. So I'm bundled up, actually. I did a smart thing. Normally, I'd just tough it out, but put on some heavy long pants, long sleeve shirt, a light jacket, and this hat. And it's keeping me... keeping the chill off. I mean, there's a September chill in the air. What's today? September 12th? Wow. Cold clouds are drifting around. It is really something. Mental health alert. It's ringing true. We're having troubles here. There's within our circle of acquaintances and etc. There's bad trouble already. It started right on the 6th of September. Just as that alert was given out, this trouble started. It's now become escalating and become out of control like a wildfire. And yet, so that's the bad news. The good news is that I've already got the answers. I already have the answers. This is true. So one way you can practice is, if it's too difficult for you to practice that you already have the answers, okay, maybe you're saying, it's too difficult. Well, you practice saying, I know someone who already has the answers. Practice that. I already know someone who already has the answers. Or if you can't do that, say, I already know someone who knows someone who has the answers. This is how you get mental health right now. It's a mental health crisis, and this is how you get mental health. very unexpected response, right? Right now, it's all about who you know. Okay, as we go into this crisis, it's all about who you know. So we petition Longchenpa. But Longchenpa, we recognize right now it's all about who you know. Therefore, we ask you to make it clear that we indeed do know you. And this is clarity about this is ample reason, we feel, for you to make yourself known to us. It's all about who you know. Because what you want to tune into is the answers are already known. Bad mental health in the world is because people think nobody has the answers. See, good mental health is having faith that someone indeed does know the answers. And I know somebody that knows somebody that knows somebody that knows somebody who knows someone who knows the answers. Okay? That will stop your free fall. It will stop it. This is why gurus are so important. So Longchenpa, keep this in mind. We have clarity about the super importance of gurus, and especially in a mental health crisis. So let this weigh heavily in your decision and deciding in our favor that you make yourself absolutely known to us in stronger and stronger ways. So people can say, I know someone who knows Longchenpa. I know someone who knows someone who knows the answers. I know someone who knows someone who knows the answers. And don't struggle with the answers. It's a little tough for you in a crisis. Most people in the world don't have the clarity at this point. So what do? You say, I know someone who has the clarity. This is what you do. So I know someone who has perfect clarity. Longchenpa, for example, has perfect clarity. So Longchenpa, let this weigh decisively in our favor. And you're considering we petition you for direct contact, and you and your buddies direct contact, so that we can say, I know someone who knows the answers. Who has the answers? I know someone who has the answers. Or, I know someone who knows someone who has the answers. This is very crucial right now. Because in trying to help others, you know, reach the answers and see what the answers are, I'm finding that they're having severe troubles. And they're thinking, does anyone really know? You know, does anyone really know? Maybe nobody knows. No, this is not true. Absolutely, there are those who know. Absolutely, Longchenpa knows. I got the answers today, and then I cross-checked him against what he has written. Clearly, he knows the answers. Clearly. And has known them for a long while. So he's very settled in these answers. So Longchenpa, we petition you to give us direct access to you. And let this fact that we recognize that you clearly have the answers weigh heavily in our favor, for favoring our petition. So, can I call to mind what the answers were? That's not important at this moment. What's important is this reaction to knowing that you know the answers, and knowing that I know someone who knows the answers, and seeing that the answers today, I said, oh my gosh, this validates what Longchenpa, he does know the answers. There's no question about it, and has known them for a long while, which is great. So that produces a shock of wow, of mental health, a shock of stability. And you'll find that those who mock, they don't know anyone who knows the answers. And in fact, they say it's not really possible. This is terrible mental health, and they will fall down and down into dreadful darkness from this standpoint. So I have always insisted that there are those who know the truth throughout my entire life. And there's been a battle my whole life of those trying to knock me off of this belief because of despair. They believe despair is the answer, is going to make them happy. So this is all important. I know someone who knows, has all the answers. I know someone who has the answers that I need. They've already received them, so I know I can as well. The mind is one. If they've done it, then I can do it also. See, so I know someone who knows the answers. I know someone who knows someone who knows the answers. I know someone who knows someone who knows someone who has the answers. Okay, so this will stop the free fall into terrible psychosis in the world. Not me or you getting the answers right at this point, but knowing someone who indeed does already have the answers. So this is one step removed from great mental health, but at least it will prevent the worst of the fall. Okay, it will prevent the worst of it. It'll prevent the worst of it. This is what we're after at this point, pragmatically. We want to avoid the worst of it so that we can pick up momentum again once these troubles subside. They won't go on forever. You know, they're brewing. Yeah, suddenly you wake up in the morning and suddenly they're there. This is very clear. So So don't struggle trying to get the answers. Okay, don't struggle. It's a little bit elusive. Okay, it's a little elusive. But the Buddha is right. Okay. Longchenpa is right. Jesus Christ is right. These Dharma kings, they're right. I've been able to validate that they have the answers. There's no question about it. No question about it. So this is what is crucial, not me regurgitating the answers, because what good is that going to do? We've been struggling, reading non-dual books, struggling with this for so long. But the globe, meanwhile, the ship is sinking. I went to this place to pick up some boxes. And the lady there said, she looked, she came back and said, I can't find anything. This could be under this name, this name, this name, this name. I said, well, try this name. She goes, okay. So he's gone a long while. I'm waiting. I'm looking at her office. In her office was this huge painting right above her desk. And my gosh, it was a sailing ship. And it was in the process of sinking. It was in the ocean, out in the heavy ocean, heavy seas. And the painting was of a ship. It was half sunk already. And there were people on the ship. And the ship was sinking. I was like, wow. Later on, I told her, that's an interesting picture you have, and she ignored me. She ignored me. Interesting. But she finally found the boxes by looking for the right name. She goes, oh, okay, it was under this name. First she said that there's nothing there, and then she went back and said, okay, I found it. So the ship is sinking, yeah. But what's a lifeboat? The lifeboats are to say, I know someone who knows someone who knows someone who knows the answers. Then we say, look, there is a transmission possibility. I mean, I know someone that is so important. It's not what you know right now, it's who you know. For the most part. Don't struggle with trying to know more. Rather, it's more important as who you know right now. If you know the Dharma kings directly, say, I know the Dharma kings. I know Dharma kings that they, I know they know the answers. So I can't, how can I possibly sink down to terrible mental health? They have the answers for me. I know they do. And they're not very difficult at all. It's just a simple shift. Okay. So the breakthroughs, insights I've had today are, you might say, extremely profound, and yet I'm not really, see, talking about them. So this should be example, setting example to all of you. It's more important that you know somebody that has all the answers and is totally stable with all of this. I can't say that about myself. I'm not totally stable, but I've glimpsed enough and seen enough and clarified enough to realize that indeed the Dharma kings are absolutely right what they say. And the non, you know, non, the high non-dual teaching, it's not, you know, it's absolutely right, okay, what the great gurus, the great Dharma kings say. They're absolutely correct about it. And we're not far away from that, actually. Not at all. So I'm trusting in what I saw today and not trying to bring it back into my mind. So this is the key to it. So I'm not struggling to recall it. I trust it. I know I got it today. There's no question about it. So now what? Okay. Now I'm reacting to having gotten it. This is called right practice. So this practice is opposite of what smartness will advise you. Opposite. Totally different practice. Smartness cannot see any value in this. Well, not enough to practice it. It will struggle with it. And so I think I see value. I'm trying to see value. Maybe I see value. But it won't actually, it'll never actually practice it. It might, you know, kind of, for a minute or two, sort of, well, is there anything here? I don't think there's anything to get here. I don't see it. That they won't practice it. This is what I have discovered. But you can say, I know someone who knows how to practice. I know someone who knows how to practice. You can do that also. I know someone who really knows how to practice. Right away, as you accept this in your mind, you will feel a great relief in you and realize, I'm not going to fall. I'm not going to fall into poor mental health. No. And I don't need to pay attention to those siren song, the sirens calling me down to my destruction. Because I know someone who knows how to practice really well. So you could use that in my case. You can refer to me as someone who really knows how to practice in the right way, which is true, because this practice has brought me the answers. But above me are the Dharma kings who are completely settled in the answers. I have received the answers, have recognized them, have accepted them, but I've been still in the shock of having succeeded, you see. They're over the shock of having succeeded. Dharma kings, there's no shock in them at all. So for me, I don't know how long it'll take, you know, for to get over the shock of having succeeded. I have no idea. I just keep practicing in the right way, and the results will take care of themselves. So you can do this. You know someone who is an expert at right practice. Or you could say, I know someone who knows the Dharma kings. I know someone who knows someone who has all the answers, who's completely over the shock of having all the answers. And then just full stop in the wow of this recognition. So again, it's not at this point, not, you know, asking, okay, well, could you give me the answer to this? It's accepting, recognizing, hey, I know someone who knows how to, is an expert at right practice. I know someone. I'm friends with them. Which is why Facebook could be used helpfully, is people, for instance, friending me. And they say, I'm a fr-, and you can say, well, I'm a friend. I'm a Facebook friend, but I'm a friend of someone who know, who's an expert in right practice and who knows those who know all the answers and have no and are completely over the shock of total success, perfect success. They've had perfect success and are completely over the shock of it. So you can say, I know I'm a friend of someone. This provides a powerful protection for you. Powerful protection. It's called apostolic protection in Christianity. If you say, I knew the apostles, what did the Christians do? Well, I know someone who knew the apostles. And I then, as it went on throughout history, he said, well, I know someone who knew someone who knew someone who knew the apostles. And of course, the apostles knew Jesus Christ. We're with him. So this is apostolic grace, you might say. This is the same principle, but this has become so attenuated that I highly suggest that we start afresh right now, okay? Saying, I know someone, you know, who knows the Dharma Kings, or I know the Dharma Kings right now, or I know someone who knows how to write practice. You actually know them. Not like, you know, 50 generations ago, I'm somehow linked. It's kind of like, say, well, I was linked. My ancestry, you know, is linked up to some king in medieval Europe or something, or some Byzantine mogul, you know, mogul, or I don't know if I know that people trace their roots back, and that gives them some sort of solace that they can, you know, I trace my roots back to King David. I'm, you know, like infinitesimally related to King David, you know, but at least I am. And they hope to get some sort of sense of reassurance or something. But here, you need a much stronger sense of reassurance now. You can say, I'm a friend of somebody who knows how to practice expertly, an expert practicer who has gotten the answers, but is still in the shock of having gotten the answers. But one step removed, one large step removed from being a bodhisattva or, you know, like that, a guru, a genuine guru, still one large step removed. Dharma prince. Dharma prince is those who know how to practice in the right way. Expert practitioners. They've seen the truth. They know the truth, but they're still in the shock of having succeeded. That you'd say a genuine Dharma prince. And so I am that. And you can say, well, I know a Dharma prince directly. You see, this is helpful. But Tibetans use this, of course. They're very wise about that. The lineages are very important in their teaching, which is, they're very wise about that. I'm part of this lineage. My guru knew this guru, and that their guru knew that one, and that one. They trace it all the way back to, you know, Garb Dorji, Samantabhadra, Garb Dorji, all the way to, you know, then to Pamasambhava, and the lineages. Every Tibetan spiritual aspirant, they all have a lineage. They all are aware of what their lineage tree is. This vital core to their religion is the lineage trees, and they have these thangkas which show their lineage tree, and they memorize their lineage tree. This so they feel I know those who have succeeded, and I know many who have succeeded, so this protects me from the worst of mental health, right? Yes, it does actually. We might say, well, that's not fair. It helps you out. Well, what do you mean? We're supposed to be helped out. And again, Christianity, similar, except it's all related back to Jesus, although some trace it back to the Old Testament. Abraham, you know, Isaac, Joseph, Judah, you know, the various tribes, and then King David, and then Joseph, Mary, and Jesus, and then the apostles, like that. And so there's a apostolic, you know, tree there, apostolic lineage tree, you might say, of the various apostles. So it's similar to Tibetan Buddhism. Tibetan Buddhism tends to have probably more branches that everybody, you know, is hooked up with some lineage. That's true. Some lineages may carry, you know, some extra profundity to them, possibly like Longchenpa. Knowing Longchenpa directly is an extraordinary lineage. Extraordinary who-you-know-ness Very, very great to know Longchenpa. That's why Longchenpa, we're calling upon you with a petition, pointing out to you how important it is for us to know someone who's really extraordinary, to give us that extra boost that we need right now, to say, I really know someone who's really someone. And we're intimidated by the Tibetans and all their lineage trees and all this kind of stuff, and we're just baffled by it, you know. But I'm just pointing out, really, it's very similar to Christianity. And in Hinduism, they have their lineage trees of all their gurus, too. Yeah, this is crucial. The gurus, who do you know? Who do you know? Who do you know? Well, in the West, it's Jesus or nothing. And they've been sabotaging Jesus to an extraordinary extent. You might say Roman Catholicism is a sabotage of Jesus. In some regard, Catholicism is not just, you know, it's not Roman Catholicism. There's a difference between Catholicism and Roman Catholicism. Roman Catholicism has various aspects which you could say is more of a bureaucratic, administrative control mechanism for an empire. It's sort of tailored for that, effective in that. But right now, Christianity is so lukewarm. For instance, can I say I know a Christian mystic who has realized God? Can I say that directly? I know one? No, I don't. I can't say that at all. You know, I might have read a book by one or something, but do I really know one? Do I know one that truly has realized the truth? I can't say that at all. So where is my lineage in Christianity at this point? This is a question. So a lot of us have felt that the lineage, that this all important, I know someone who knows someone who knows someone, has become too weak in Christianity. Too weak. So a lot of us have turned to like some other, you know, Tibetan Buddhism, for instance. And so there's the Rinpoche right there. There's the Tulku, you know. And they're just like, you know, oh my God, I know a Tulku. You know, I know a Rinpoche. And the Rinpoche has this lineage. And see, for them, that's like, they're so happy to find that, to feel that. They don't really understand non-dual teaching, no. And the Rinpoche may not be quite understand it as well as they could, perhaps. Maybe they're still in the shock of success or something. Maybe they're a Dharma prince or something. Or maybe not even that. Part of the tradition. You know, it varies. Some of their recognitions are much more stable. They're much more stable in the recognitions than others. But just to say, yeah, I know someone, or I'm a friend. But it's even better to say, I'm actually a friend. I actually met them. I know them. You know, this helps us. It helps us. But the lineage trees of Tibetan, it's like, wow, can I have something a little more direct? I mean, who are the heavyweights? Well, Pama Samava's one, Longchenpa's one. You go back to some of these, and then other traditions, you know, Tilopa, Naropa, Milarepa, you know, Tsongkhapa, you know, the various founders of these different branches of Tibetan Buddhism, and you say, well, I know some, but do you really know someone who actually knows someone who knows someone? So it's a little bit attenuated, right? It's been around for quite some time, 1500 years, not quite that long, but close to it. And how about right now we just say, look, I know someone who knows Longchenpa directly. That just really is strong for us. It's strong. Or you could say, I know someone who knows Jesus Christ directly. Now, I know all these Dharma kings. I've met them directly, but I'm requesting Longchenpa to give us a more direct access to him at this point, so that people can feel that they know someone who knows, really knows Longchenpa. This is very helpful. So this has the best. It's direct, and it's also Tibetanish. It's Dzogchenish. It's non-dualish. All the stuff that we're looking for help in, it's got all of that. Has all of that. So Longchenpa, listen to what we say here and keep all of this in mind as we petition you for more direct help here, that we get the gist of it, how important it is. How important it is. People will take refuge in who they know and take solace in who they know. And if they don't know anyone, that knows someone who has all the answers, they're going to be in bad shape, really bad shape. You know, they'll Google it. Answers, Google. I want answers. So they'll rely upon Google and what's that, Siri or something, or sorry, I don't have the answers. Is that what they did? There was a sorry? Yeah, sorry, I don't have that answer. I don't know anyone who has the answers. Do you know anyone? Sorry, you know anyone knows has all the answers? Sorry, I don't know anyone who has all the answers. There does no such thing. Oh, wow. Even Google doesn't have the answers. I guess we're doomed. Yeah, it's funny, but it's true, isn't it? Sorry, I don't know what it is. I've never used it. I've never seen anybody using it. Their smartphones asking a question. It's not used very often. People turn to their smartphones for the answers now. See, this is doomed. This is dooming them to this perdition of misery, really. So when I just full stop in the wow, it means I'm acknowledging that I did get the answer. I'm not going back and looking back. Did I really get the answer? It's like when you come to an intersection, you look down there, you see no cars, you look there, no cars, and then you pull out. You don't say, wait a minute, let me look here again. 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 I remember I had a near accident once. I don't even know what happened. I thought I had the right of way. Someone else thought I didn't. And it was a miraculous escape. I don't know, it was just unbelievable. It was just a grace of God that I don't even know how I didn't, you know, get T-boned. But after that near escape, I became paranoid about intersections. Of like, do I have the right of way? I mean, can I go? Are you gonna stop? Because I thought they were supposed to stop, and they didn't. And they thought I was supposed to stop, and I didn't. So I'd look one direction and say, okay. And then I'd say, look again. Are you going to, in the car, are you going to stop? Like if there's a stop sign, I wouldn't go. I'd make sure they stop. And then I'd like, ugh. So I've experienced this trouble we have. Where we keep looking, we keep peeking, we keep peeking, we keep peeking, we keep peeking, we keep peeking. And this produces this feeling like, I'm not sure. Whereas if we refuse to look, we get the answer and we say, I know. Okay, it's obvious. Wow, it's obvious, totally obvious. It's totally obvious. Truth is very simple, totally obvious. Words, of course, only point us in the direction. So once you glimpse and see it, then you say, okay, those words did point me in the right direction, but they're not the answer themselves. It's what I saw, what I experienced as the answer. So don't go back and say, were those the right words? Well, can I have better words? Are those the right words? No, because then you're superficializing it, conceptualizing it. Instead, just realize you did see the truth. You did see it. You did experience it. Don't take another peek. Don't look again. Don't look again. Refuse to look again. I'm doing this right now. I'm refusing to look at it until the shock of success wears off. Until the shock of success wears off. This is right practice. So we must keep in mind that the super positivity trumps super negativity. Okay, it trumps it. Now, political candidates use this principle to catapult themselves into power, is by meeting all these people directly on the campaign trail. People say, "Hey, I met this candidate, you know, or I met the future president," and then someone else will say, "Well, yeah, I didn't myself, but I know somebody who did. My brother or sister met them, or my parents met them, or my friend met them directly." So I know somebody who met this political, you know, candidate for presidency. And if they become president, you say, "Well, I met the president. He was on the campaign trail. I shook their hand." So they use this. They co-opt this principle from spiritual truth to their advantage, because then people feel, "I know someone who's powerful, who can get me what I want. You know, I know someone." Yeah, and they give you the impression. The candidates give the impression that they look you in the eye and they say, "Yeah, I'm your friend." So it's the real slick ones, like Slick Willie, is good at that. You know, they're generally, those who become president are very good at that. Is they'll shake your hand, look you in the eye, and they'll give you sort of this knowing look, like, "I'll remember you when I'm in office. I'll remember you. I remember meeting you. Absolutely, I do. I remember what you need. I'll get it for you. Don't worry. You got a friend in office. You got a friend, a personal friend." So they give you the sense that somehow by meeting them, you're their personal friend. This is what candidates for office do. It's not policy, is that, do you feel that they're your friend? It's like, who do you know? Who do you know? And they send you stuff in the mail all the time from the office of the president, and a letter, you know, it looks like they signed it themselves, and they say, "Hi," so they call you by name. This is all marketing, you know, using the psychology of this stuff to empower dictators, tyrants, rulers, leaders, all these kinds of stuff. But the real McCoy is the Dharma kings, the gurus, the saints, the apostles. Okay, that's where we need to use this principle. So who do you know is very important. Do I care if I know either of the political candidates in the United States? No, I don't care at all. I have no interest in meeting them whatsoever. I've never had any interest in meeting presidents or potentates or any of that kind of stuff. If they walk down the street, it is, you know, Billy Clinton, Willie Clinton, Slick Willie Clinton was in town, and I didn't go to try and see him at all. I said, I don't have any interest in trying to meet. He doesn't have any power. He doesn't have the answers. He doesn't have any answers. The president doesn't have the answers. They don't know the answers at all. They're completely clueless as to what truth is. Completely clueless. They're just very slick campaigners. And we just hope and assume that they know what they're doing, and They give us the impression that they certainly do. All this all-wise kind of look, like, "Yes, don't worry, I know how to get you what you want." So we're talking about the Dharma King, Longchenpa, who absolutely, truly does know all the answers. And you say, "Well, that's a lot." No, it's very simple, actually. It's very simple. Knows the simple truth. Simple truth is devastatingly obvious and simple. It absolutely gives the lie to all our attempts to generate despair. So knowing Longchenpa, that's really something. All right, that's means you know some, you know, you really know someone. That's very important. Super important. Who true you know someone who actually has all the answers. All the answers we seek, he already has them all. So that's important. Knowing someone, knowing Longchenpa is very important. So Longchenpa, keep this in mind. We recognize how important it is that we know you or know someone that knows you. This is super critical. We're not fools here anymore. We never were fools, actually. We're just accepting that fact that we never really were total fools. No, we always had wisdom in us. So keep this in mind that we're recognizing our wisdom. Oh boy, what is this? Okay. All right. Well, that's good. Okay. These stupid messages, they take forever to load. I don't know. Can I not reply to it? No. I don't know. There you go. Good. Okay. That's important. We're having a meltdown here in our with the mental health of this red. Never seen this icon appear before. A flashing red. What does that mean? Flashing red. New message? There's no new message. Wow, this is weird. There's this flashing red icon, like a message icon with a bubble with dot 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 in it, and it's flashing. And that's it, flashing red. I've never seen that before. Good Lord, what does that mean? I can't get rid of it. Typical weird. I don't know. Phones are just. I don't. Not so interested in them. Again, say I have a smartphone, so I know something that has all the answers. This is what they're marketing. I know I have something that knows all the answers. I have a smartphone. I have access to all the answers. This is what people are hoping. It's false hope. The trouble is there's so much false hope in the world. At some point, we're going to collapse. The mental health of the world's going to collapse because they realize I don't really know anyone who has the answers. And then the panic sets in. That won't happen here, but Longchenpa, we petition you with the recognition of this very important dynamic in the world, how we actually do need to know someone who is legitimately has all the answers, and we are petitioning you because we know you do have all the answers. Okay, that's why we're petitioning. We're not petitioning our smartphone. Okay, we're not shopping for a better smartphone. I mean, it's genius marketing. Is they keep putting out new phone, new phone, new phone, because they got you hooked, and you know that the one you got doesn't quite have all the answers, and you think, oh, the new one. Then they say, yeah, the new one has all the answers. So, oh, great, I gotta get it. It's a severe addiction, actually. Very clever. It's just still flashing red. Well, I'm gonna shut the phone off, and see what's going on here. Never seen this icon. Maybe that's a emergency alert. Emergency alert. Emergency alert. Emergency alert. Rethink. It's flashing again. Dang, what the heck's going on here? I don't know what to say. Is it an emergency alert or something? No? You know what that is? Flashing red. No? Gosh. Okay, that's a warning, isn't it? Or it could be something else. It could be a symbol of the red hats, Longchenpa, the red hat, as one of the symbols. I almost wear a red hat to taping. I wore a red hat today in petitioning Longchenpa. And this icon flashing with a, I don't think you'll be able to see this, but no. Let's see. Oh, there you go. You can see it. Yeah. See that? What is that? There's a red, you know, it's that cartoon thing of the, someone's commenting. Someone has a comment. Someone has a message. And it's a red. So the red hats have a message for me. Okay, you can look at it like that, meaning Longchenpa has a message for me. Wow. Again, this never happened on this phone. So it's something amazing here, as far as the timing of it goes. So maybe this indication Longchenpa is indeed messaging us. Wow. Great. So guru yoga is so important. This will free us from the political misappropriation of this dynamic, this all-important helpfulness, you might say. Who do you know? The politicians don't have the answers at all. They don't know the truth at all. They're blind leaders of the blind. Every one of them, every last single one of them, are blind leaders of the blind. Do not put your faith in politicians and political solutions. What we need is a heavenly infusion. I mean, the infusion of the Dharma kings, of a guru, of a guru. One is enough as far as direct contact goes. It's more important to have direct contact with one than to not have direct contact with a number of them. So, but keep this in mind, Longchenpa. We've selected you as the one we have direct contact with. And it's very important to have that focus in on direct contact with at least one Dharma king. So then people can begin saying, I know someone who knows a Dharma king, has direct contact with a Dharma king. This is very important. And then the whole chain, ladder, I know someone who knows someone thing, can start to happen. And then this, people will no longer worry about the politicians and all that kind of stuff. They'll say, well, I mean, what do I care? You know, I mean, I know someone who knows someone who knows Longchenpa. I mean, what am I worried about? I mean, this is, we're talking about genuine salvation here. Real salvation. I know the way. I know someone who knows the way, absolutely knows the way for me, totally knows the way, and is confident that I can succeed at the way. I know someone who knows the way and is confident I can succeed at the way. See, or I know someone who knows someone who totally knows the way and is totally confident that I can succeed at the way. And then politicians and all these celebrities and politicians, they just, you know, they just melt away as far as importance in your life. Celebrities walking down the street, I'm not going to get up from my meditation to gawk at the celebrity or the president or anything. I'm focusing on the fact that I know somebody who knows someone who knows everything that I need to know and is confident that I can know it as well. Okay, so this puts the culture on the right footing. Well, right now it's on the wrong footing. We have the wrong foundation for a culture right now, folks. This is inescapably true. Inescapably true. A celebrity, political, demagoguery, idolistic culture, you know, this stuff, it won't fly. It won't fly. And then we get this feeling of being grounded, and it feels horrible, and we panic. So we can't fly, we can't fly. What's wrong? Yeah. Oh. It's still okay. It's still messaging me. Wow, that's amazing. It's not, it doesn't say call voicemail or anything. So, in like Roman Catholicism, we'd say, well, we go to church, say, well, I know someone, the priest, who knows someone, the bishop, who knows someone, the cardinal, who knows someone, the pope, who knows the succession of popes, back to Peter, who knows, was connected to Peter, and then Peter knows Jesus. So they go to church, they feel that they really know someone. It's like, well, but in as far as actual juice goes, I've observed it all very carefully. Very weak tea indeed. But it gives at least this faint feeling like, I know someone who knows all the answers. The priest knows all the answers. That the priest says, we don't really know all the answers. Nobody can, but God sacrificed Jesus and, saved us from our sins or something. And they kind of do this song and dance that kind of is actually very discouraging. Actually is very much producing despair. I've noticed this. It's actually saying you can't be liberated right now, but after you die, you can. And this provides an ersatz kind of relief because they say, oh, you mean I get to keep on trying to generate despair? Oh, great, because I thought that Jesus really wanted me to drop that right now. But you're saying, no, wait until you've had a full life of despair, and then maybe you can drop it. But after you die, who knows? You're out of the picture, so you can't really comment whether it worked or not. They want to say, no, they say, our way only works after you die. And of course, that way, dead people tell no tales. Nobody can say, hey, wait a minute, it didn't work. But of course, I came back reincarnated, and I can say it didn't work. It doesn't work. It doesn't work. It doesn't work. What they're saying doesn't work at all. That's why they don't want reincarnation. They don't want people recognize, hey, wait a minute. You said I wouldn't have to come back. I came back. It didn't work. So it's very much that way. Now, I tell you this, every single one of us at every instant is completely free to choose a dream with a different purpose that emphasizes inherent spaciousness instead of the decoration of inherent spaciousness, which we call nature, the world. Sensory perception inherently emphasizes form, what we call form process, time space process form, discrete concretization, things. That's what we designed it for. It cannot see inherent spaciousness. It cannot see inherent spaciousness. Inherent spaciousness is a spiritual perception. We perceive it with our spirit, with our awareness. And it's here all the time. It's just that we are emphasizing the decorate ornamentation and not overlooking the inherent spaciousness of what it's decorating. We're overlooking what is it decorating. We're overlooking it like a shadow. We just don't seem to be able to, just vaguely, I can't really see it. It's out there. It's out there, and this is what's in here is different than what's out there. It's called otherness. We see otherness. People, we try to put it into personal terms like I and you. No, but it's all about nature. It's all perception about everything we see. Body, a tree, anything. It's all about otherness. That what's outside the tree, spaciousness-wise, is different than what's inside the tree. The tree has a different type of spaciousness than the air around it or the mountain or something. So this is false perception. This is not true. Where spiritual perception will see that it's all exactly the same spaciousness everywhere. Vision of Christ, guru vision, this is what it is. So this seeing otherness is just a dream. We're making up this dream to produce despair, try to generate despair in us, and try to then therefore modify what we are. So it's a dream of modification. It's a dream of modification. So what we do, we can choose, though, since we're dreaming the dream of modification, we can dream a different dream. We can dream a dream of non-modification. And when we dream a dream, choose, we just make a choice. I want to emphasize non-modification, a dream of non-modification, and then we'll see inherent spaciousness. It's just that simple. That's it. So it's a simple choice on our part. The dream has no power over us whatsoever. It has no, we are all free this very instant and every instant. Every single one of us is perfectly free. Every instant that will ever arise, we are perfectly free to choose to emphasize, a dream of emphasizing non-modification. And then from that dream, after we get used to that dream, the shock of success and shock, realize, oh, there's no such thing as modification. Wow. Then ultimately, we can drop dreaming altogether and just directly experience reality, the non-modifiable nature of reality. But that's nothing. We don't need to concern ourselves with that. That'd be down the road for all of us, quite a ways down the road. So we dream a dream of non-modification that emphasizes non-modification. And we can do that right now. We don't have to die at all. So this idea that you can't go to heaven until you die is utterly ridiculous. The kingdom of heaven is right here, right now, as Jesus said. The kingdom of heaven is here now. It's at hand. The kingdom of heaven is at hand. It's right here. Which is seeing a dream of emphasizing non-modification. Of seeing an inherent spaciousness is what you see when you look at the world, look at nature. You're now seeing, oh, it's the same spaciousness everywhere. And it's not being modified by all this dance of decoration at all. You actually literally see it that way. That's called guru vision, or vision of Christ. And this, you're seeing a dream of the kingdom of heaven, at least, right? So, and that's good enough. Jesus said, that's good enough. That's all you need. From there, it's a very easy step, once you get over the shock of success, to the true kingdom of heaven. Not even a dream of it. So, again, right off the bat, though, if there's anyone who you think knows the truth, this is what they should be telling you directly, very easily, very directly. Every single one of us, without a single exception, is completely free every single moment, without a single exception, to choose once again, choose a dream of non-modification. All right? This is a fact, and this is our salvation. So we're free to choose salvation. Every one of us, without exception, every single moment without exception, is completely free to choose their salvation for themselves right now. Right now. Right here, right now. No matter where they seem to be, wherever it is, right here, right now, there's no obstruction, there's no obstacle at all. There's zero obstacle to realization. As Ramana Maharshi said, there are no obstacles to meditation. The thought that there are obstacles, he says, is the obstacle. Okay, but they said there really isn't any. So all you need to do is drop the demand that there be obstacles, and you'll realize there isn't any obstacle. You're free. We're free to choose salvation right now. Dream of no modification. This is the answer. If you want to know the answer, it's that simple. It's that simple. Someone's barbecuing or something. Wood smoke. I always get nervous, you know, when you smell smoke, right? So don't respond to those who are trying to stir up trouble and try to fix it at that level. It's impossible. And rather turn to, who do you know? Do you know someone who has the answers? That's what's important. And don't say, no, I've got to get the answers, and then you'll cling to it. Just say, well, I know someone who has the answers. I know that. And you can glimpse the answers, but we don't need to overemphasize it. It's more important, who do you know? So my restless mind, the answer is not to subdue restless mind at all. The answer is quiet mind. And quiet mind is just quiet mind. That's what it is. That's all it is. Quiet mind is not the result of suppressing restless mind. Not at all. Restless mind is just a dream, fake mind. So subduing a fake mind and trying to make a fake mind quiet is the path of delusion. is the path of despair. And that's what Buddha took, the meditative path of trance states. That this is actually all you end up is with trance states, and that's not it. Then the other side of that coin is trying to destroy the seeker who's trying to subdue restlessness. Say, okay, subduing restlessness is, that's wrong. That's not the answer. So let's get rid of the one who's trying to subdue restlessness. And this is like blamed on the body or something is causing this. And so we try to mortify the body and the flesh, etc. And that's asceticism, which Buddha tried next. And then he finally realized, that's not the answer either. It's just simply accept quiet mind as it is. Don't try to do anything with restless mind. Don't try to subdue it, and don't try to not subdue it. Don't try to subdue it, and don't try to not subdue it. So you might be saying, that's it, isn't it? Yes, it is. And this shows up in choosing a different dream. We choose a dream of non-modification, emphasizing that, and we see inherent spaciousness, and that's quiet mind. We are able to function in the world just fine with this recognition. We see everything still, trees, everything, but we see that there's no otherness anywhere. That's all. Just inherent spaciousness without the sense of otherness. Two different kinds of spaciousness. There's just one spaciousness. It's smoothly everywhere. So, these are the answers. Very simple. But the shock of recognition, that's quite strong. So my whole life is like I always practice. I'm going to know the answers. I know someone knows the answers, therefore I'm going to know the answers. That's basically what I practice in my life. I am going to know the answers, no doubt about it. And then it was really shocking because it's just like unheard of. What? You? Who could, are you kidding me? It's just there's such great disbelief in the world right now, isn't there? And people say, I get that somebody might be able to get the answers, maybe, but you? But you. Ridiculous. I know you, and I know you don't know the answers. What they're really saying is, I don't want to know anyone that knows the answers, because I want despair. So they say, I want to know you. I want you to be my friend, but in order to be my friend, you have to say that you don't know the answers, and you don't know anyone that does know the answers. Otherwise, I'll be uncomfortable around you, because my goal is despair, which is the arrogance of believing we can somehow modify ourselves, and despair is what we think is the means to modify what we are. What God created. And I know 100% for sure, we cannot modify what we are. Despair does not modify what we are at all. Not in the slightest bit. Totally futile, ridiculous, chasing our own tail, so to speak, going around in circles. Haven't gotten anywhere. But people mock you because they say, I want an ally in despair, and you say that you know the answers. I don't want that. So you can't possibly know that stuff, they say. Yeah, that's the problem. So how can anyone come out of the spiritual closet and say, I know the answers, or I know someone who knows the answers? People will say, no, you don't. You're arrogant. Egotistical, arrogant. Whereas actually, it's egotistical and arrogant to insist that nobody knows the answers and to believe that despair is the answer. That's what's egotistical and arrogant, because that's based on an effort to change what we are. So,